Good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome to St. Peter's Lutheran Church. This Sunday will be the 17th Sunday after Pentecost. And in God's Word, we are reminded that our gracious Heavenly Father leads us to forgive one another just as in Christ He has forgiven us. We begin with hymn 238. Stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God who created us to love and serve Him as His dear children, but we have disobeyed Him and deserve only His wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to Him and plead for His mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, He has removed your guilt forever. You are His own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to His will. Amen. In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord.
Our Father,
Let us pray. Lord, we pray that your mercy and grace may always go before and follow after us, that loving you with undivided hearts, we may be ready for every good and useful work. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The first lesson is recorded in Genesis chapter 50. True forgiveness means bearing no grudges. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "It may be that Joseph will hate us and will pay us back in full for all of the evil that we did to him." They sent the following message to Joseph: "Before he died, your father commanded us, 'You are to tell Joseph, please forgive the offense of your brothers and their sin, because they did evil to you. Now please forgive the offense of the servants of the God of your father.'" Joseph wept when they spoke to him. His brothers came and fell down in front of him, and they said, "See now, we are your servants." Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. For am I in the place of God? You meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring this to pass and to keep many people alive as it is this day. Now therefore do not be afraid. I will nourish you and your little ones." He comforted them and spoke to them in a kind way. This is the word of our God. Alleluia. The second lesson is recorded in the Apostle Paul's letter to the Christians in Ephesus, chapter 4. Christ's forgiveness drives us to forgive one another in love. "Do not let any unwholesome talk come from your mouths. Say only what is beneficial when there is a need to build up others, so that it will be a blessing to those who hear. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of every kind of bitterness, rage, anger, quarreling, and slander, along with every kind of malice. Instead, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving one another just as God in Christ has forgiven you. Therefore, be imitators of God as his dearly loved children, and walk in love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." This is the word of our God. We sing hymn 391.
Oh,
We stand in reverence for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is recorded in Matthew chapter 18, beginning with the 21st verse. Then Peter came up and asked Jesus, "Lord, how many times must I forgive my brother when he sins against me? As many as 7 times?" Jesus said to him, "Not 7 times, but I tell you as many as 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle them, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Because the man was not able to pay the debt, his master ordered that he be sold, along with his wife, children, and all that he owned, to repay the debt. Then the servant fell down on his knees in front of him, saying, 'Master, be patient with me, and I will pay you everything.' The master of that servant had pity on him, released him, and forgave him the debt. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. He grabbed him and began choking him, saying, 'Pay me what you owe me.' So this fellow servant fell down and begged him, saying, 'Be patient with me, and I will pay you back.' But he refused. Instead, he went off and threw the man into prison until he could pay back what he owed. When his fellow servants saw what had happened, they were very distressed. They went and reported to their master everything that had happened. Then his master called him in and said to him, 'You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt when you begged me to. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow servant, just as I had mercy on you?' His master was angry and handed him over to the jailers until he could pay back everything he owed him. This is what my heavenly Father will also do to you unless each one of you forgives his brother from his heart." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
The congregation may be seated. After our Lord Jesus ascended into heaven, the church in Jerusalem steadily grew, so much so that there was so much work to do that it was too much for the 12 apostles to take care of. And so they assigned 7 men to assist them in their work. One of those men, his name was Stephen. He was filled with the grace and the power of God. He was a masterful preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and this enraged Christ's enemies. And so they falsely accused Stephen of speaking against the law of Moses, of speaking against the temple in Jerusalem. And so they had him appear before the Jewish ruling council. And there Stephen made a defense of himself, and his defense enraged them so much that they dragged him outside of the city gates, and they started to stone him to death. And as they stoned him to death, Stephen prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." And then he fell on his knees, and he prayed, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." And then he fell asleep and he woke up in heaven. How in the world could Stephen show so much grace in the face of such a horrible injustice? Most people who would be unjustly executed would be prone to be cursing his or her murderers, but not Stephen. Why not? Because Stephen believed the truth that our Lord Jesus teaches us in this portion of God's word today when he says, the forgiven forgive. First of all, you and I will marvel at the fact that our merciful God freely forgives our immeasurable debt of sin. And then this will drive you and me to want to freely forgive the puny debt of others. Jesus had said to his disciples, if a brother sins against you, go and show him his fault just between the two of you, and if he listens to you, you have won your brother over. This got Peter to thinking, and he asked Jesus, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times? And no doubt Peter thought that he was being generously and mercifully forgiving, because the Jewish rabbis taught that you only had to forgive somebody three times. After that, they were not deserving of forgiveness. But Jesus said, no, I tell you, not seven times, but up to 77 times. With those words, Jesus wasn't telling us to keep a record of the sins people commit against us. And when the 77th offense happens, then you shouldn't forgive anymore. Rather, Jesus is telling us that we are to forgive others as often as they sin against us. Now, when it comes to the forgiving of sins and for asking forgiveness, our old Adam rebels against that. Our sinful nature, our sinful flesh has a keen sense of justice. And when we are done wrong, we don't want to forgive. We want vengeance. We want payback. We want to stew over past wrongs. And we want to bear a grudge. It's like that man who had a neighbor that sinned against him, and the neighbor felt guilty, and the neighbor came over to him, and he said, I've sinned against you, please forgive me. But the man refused to forgive him. He refused to forgive him for decades. But then finally on his deathbed, his family convinced him to forgive the neighbor so that he could leave this world with a clear conscience. And so he invited his neighbor to his bedside, and his neighbor said, please, forgive me, I've sinned against you. And the man said, I forgive you, no hard feelings. And the relieved neighbor said, thank you so much. And he made his way to the door. And as he was going out the door, the dying man said, of course, if I get better, all of this is off. So is the nature of our sinful flesh. The old Adam in us recoils at the idea of forgiving somebody else. And so how are you and I to weed out of our lives that bitterness and that resentment that lurks in our sinful nature? We do that by marveling at the truth Jesus teaches us with this parable. In the parable, the king, of course, who wants to settle accounts with his servants, that king is none other than the God of glory himself. The first servant brought in owed him 10,000 talents. In today's money, that would be 22 billion and a half, over 22 and a half billion dollars, a debt that this man certainly could not ever pay off. Of course, that servant who owed that huge debt represents you and me. You and I have an immeasurable debt of sin charged up against us in our relationship with our high and holy God. You and I came kicking and screaming out of our mother's womb in rebellion against our God, in rebellion against His holy law. In our youth, we were selfish, we were lazy, we were disobedient to our parents and others in authority. Throughout our lives, every filthy, dirty thought and word, every act of sexual immorality or overindulgence, every hurtful, hateful feeling and slander, every evil gossip, every time we were short with our parents, with our spouses, with our siblings, with our children, with our family, and with our friends, every single corrupt contemplation, wicked work, and devilish deed is an offense against our high and holy God. Just like that servant, our debt against our God is immeasurable. We could never, ever pay it off. And because that servant could not pay off his debt, the king ordered that he and his wife and his family and everything he owned be sold to pay off the debt. So also, just like that servant, because we cannot pay off our immeasurable debt of sin against our God, we deserve to be sold over to the eternal flames of hell. What is our only chance? To plead for mercy, just like the man in the parable did. He threw himself before his master. He groveled. He pleaded, "Please be patient with me and I'll pay it all off." Of course, the king knew there was no way he would ever be able to pay off that debt. So what did he do? He had mercy on him. He pitied him. And he decided to pay the debt himself, and he released his servant from that debt. In like manner, our only hope of being released from the debt of our iniquities and the punishment of our crimes against God's holiness is to plead for mercy, to fall down on our faces before him, to beat our breasts and say, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." And what does our God do, our merciful God? He fully and freely releases us from the immeasurable debt of our sin. But, you know, he can't just overlook that debt. It has to be paid. And so he paid it himself. That debt was paid. It was doled out in the holy, precious blood that flowed from our Savior's precious veins on Golgotha's cross. There he endured the debt of our iniquity, which is the punishment of hell. And before he died, he cried out, "It is finished," which means paid in full. And he died. And on the third day, the Heavenly Father showed that our debt of sin has been taken care of by raising Jesus from the dead. Praise the Lord that our merciful God freely forgives our immeasurable debt of sin. And now that's going to drive you and me to freely forgive the puny debt of others. Well, that's really easy to say, isn't it? But then the devil and our own sinful nature get in the way of our wanting to lovingly forgive others. That's what Jesus warns us of in this parable. The man who had been forgiven that huge debt, he went out and he found one of his fellow servants. This servant owed him 100 denarii. It was $7,250. And he violently grabbed him by the neck, trying to squeeze the payment out of him, and said, as he choked him, he said, "Pay me what you owe me." The man also pleaded and begged, "Please be patient with me and I'll pay you back." But the unmerciful servant said no. He refused to forgive him. He went off. He threw him into jail until he should pay the entire debt back. And of course, being in jail, he couldn't work, so he would never, ever be able to pay that debt back. His fellow servants were grieved. They were greatly distressed. They went and reported this great injustice to the king. The king was enraged. He summoned that servant, that unmerciful servant, and he said, "You wicked person, you. Didn't I cancel your entire debt just because you asked me to? Should have you not shown the same kind of mercy on your fellow servant as I had on you? And then he threw him into prison. He handed him over to the jailers until he should pay his entire debt. But in the original Greek language, it says he was handed over to be tormented until he could pay that entire debt. You see, in that parable, Jesus says, this is how my heavenly Father will treat each one of you if you do not forgive your brother from the heart. In that parable, when that unmerciful servant refused to forgive his fellow servant, he was showing that he did not appreciate the forgiveness of his immeasurable debt. And by refusing to forgive, he forfeited the mercy of the king and was forced to suffer without end. So also, God wants us to forgive one another, just as in Christ, God has forgiven us. But then we'll say, well, those who refuse to forgive show that they are unbelievers, and they forfeit the forgiveness that Christ won for them, but not me. I'll forgive, but then we're tempted to say, but I won't forget. We'll say, I'll bury the hatchet, but then we leave the handle sticking out of the ground so we can easily find it later and get it out when we need to attack the person who has sinned in the past and that we had supposedly forgiven. It's like the husband who said to his wife, honey, you said you forgave and you forgot. Why do you keep reminding me of my past sins? And she said, honey, I have forgiven and I have forgotten, but I keep reminding you of your past sins so you remember that I have forgiven and forgotten. Well, that's not forgiveness, is it? What did our God teach us about forgiveness, what true forgiveness is? In Isaiah 45, he says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. That's how thoroughly God forgives you in Christ. He remembers your sins no more. That's how thoroughly God wants you to forgive those who have sinned against you. If you think about it, there is no way that even our worst enemies on this earth could ever sin against us as often as we have sinned against our God, because all of our sins, the thousands upon thousands, the millions of sins in thought, word, and deed, every one of them is against God, an offense to him. But what does he do? Our merciful God freely forgives our immeasurable debt of sin. How can we do anything other than forgive the puny debt of sin of others? And so when someone comes to you and says, I've sinned against you, I'm sorry, forgive me, you can lovingly reassure that person and say, forgiven, forgotten, forever. Amen. Please stand. And the God of peace himself will soon crush Satan under your feet. The Lord be with all of you. Amen. We confess the only saving faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The congregation may be seated. Our seventh graders, Faith Christensen, is going to be undergoing surgery on Monday, so we'll keep her in our prayers. Wayne and Carol Bornick will be celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary on September 26th. Please stand for prayer. Oh Lord God, we thank you for the wondrous gift of Jesus Christ, your Son, and for the promised graces we have received through him. We thank you that through his perfect life and his obedience to death on the cross, we have been granted cleansing and pardon for all our sins. We thank you that in his resurrection we have the promise of life everlasting, and that in his ascension to the right hand of your majesty, we have the assurance that he continually intercedes for us. Help us believe and trust in him, love and serve him, that in all our thoughts, words, and actions we may manifest his Spirit. Rebuke our selfishness and subdue our self-indulgence. Deepen our sympathy, strengthen our hope, and confirm us in our faith. Dwell in our homes, O Lord, and let the trust of our families be centered in you alone, so that no difficulty, trial, or adversity rob us of the conviction that you are our helper in every time of need. Relieve the afflictions of the weary and the sick, and dry the tears of the troubled and sorrowful. Lead them to look to you as the unfailing spring of healing and hope. Lead us to forgive one another just as in Christ you have forgiven us. All these things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We commend Faith Christensen into your care as she undergoes surgery. We pray that you would grant success to the surgery and bring about a full and speedy recovery. We join with Wayne and Carol Bornick in thanking you for 50 years of blessings on their marriage. Be with them in the days to come as you have been in the past, and continue to fill their hearts and their home with your love. Amen. And we join our Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for hymn 389.
Oh,
Lord God, our Heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation, and bestow on us your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Amen.